listen, maybe one day we'll capture a fighting machine, eh?
Back on this, reading chapter 21, at Abbotsdale. So they're approaching a village. If I remember rightly, that's the one where there's a manor house where the military are gathered. So the soldiers have all heaped up their weapons and they've covered it in a tarp to hide it from the Martians' eyes. So inside the manor house, they've spread a map out over the table and they're all kind of using it as like a war room strategic map to find out where the Martians have landed. They appear to be using the Marvin's megaphone, which is like a radio broadcast thing, a government propaganda machine. They're using that to instead broadcast to people inside the cordon saying you're not alone, as if they're going to try and mount some rescue attempt for anyone trapped in the Martian lines. They're mentioning some weird wireless technology called crystal sets. I'm not sure what that's referring to, but they're saying it's better than the Marvin's megaphone radio things for communicating wirelessly. But they're saying all this wireless radio technology is quite short range. One of the sappers says he wants to tunnel all the way under the Martians to lay like communication cables. So there's more kind of Brave New World underground digging stuff going on. It's a Tuesday and the Martians have apparently left their encampment on this first day on the Earth. They're saying once the Martians had left the cordon to explore, they've fanned out quickly in several groups and they're all heading for different targets to attack. There's a lot of fighting machines on the Earth and they're thinking that there's over 200 of them over the whole Earth. Some of the Martian groups are attacking military bases at Aldershot and Colchester. Some of them have gone to Salisbury Plain, and they've killed a lot of people there. There's a moment where a fighting machine stands over Stonehenge for some reason. I guess it's like, if you're making this into a film, we need a dramatic trailer shot to get them with all the landmarks. It could be that because the Martians are hyper-intelligent, one's gone to Stone Age and is kind of doing a little history mission. It's looking down and going, like, what is this arrangement? This is something from their past of the humans. Navy dockyards at Chatham and Portsmouth have been attacked by the Martians, but the capital ships all went out to sea before it happened. And the Martians, well, they didn't think the Martians could follow, but we'll have a little bit of information on that later in the book. They're mentioning Winston Churchill's the one who gave the order for the boats to leave harbour. So they're doing their celebrity thing still. It's kind of annoying, to be fair. And they're saying wherever the Martians go through the countryside, they're attacking infrastructure, like railways and telegraph wires, blowing up electrical power plants and gas lines and piles of coal. But it is saying at least two Martians have been killed by lucky shots from artillery. So that harkens back to the first book, War of the Worlds, where the Martians aren't like these invulnerable superpower things that can't be killed or damaged by the humans. The humans do kill a few of them in the first book, and they will in this. And then by Wednesday, the Martians have gotten to a position where they can attack London. Chapter 22. How the Martians moved out of the cordon. We're still with Frank. He's been offered a room at the manor house, but instead he goes all humble and beds down on a straw-filled mattress in the village hall of Abbotsdale, which is the village that they're in. So he goes to sleep there under a pile of clothes. He's woken up by aircraft engines. There's orange light coming in through the curtains. A little bit of kind of atmosphere setting there, which I would appreciate. So he grabs his clothes and boots and jacket and his revolver and heads off. The aircraft sounds like it's coming from the north and the east. Someone rips open the curtain on the village hall that faces north, and there's a sky full of drifting orange sparks. Don't quite know what the description is trying to say here. It sounds like they're trying to say the orange sparks are flares falling from the sky. And then someone sees a silhouette of a Martian, like a man on stilts, walking under it all. Anyway, Fairfield's asked for Frank, so Verity's got him up. They go out into the road, which is all kind of lit up orange by the flares. The Martian central pit is in Amersham, and that's where all the flares seem to be concentrated. There are civilians out in the street with the soldiers and children. And the fighting machines are, like, not only silhouetted against the orange sky, but they're, like, casting shadows. Well, the flares are casting the Martians' shadows long on the ground as they move around. Seems like the Martians gather up together and kind of leave to the east. I'm not sure why they're kind of evacuating that direction. They're saying because of the shadows, it's hard to count the fighting machines, but they count about three. Fairfield turns up in a peaked cap in the street with them. He says the military has scouts moving around following the Martians. The Martians are firing their heat rays now, and the people who are launching the flares, I'm not quite sure from where, but whoever's launching the flares is getting attacked by the heat rays. So maybe that's why the Martians moved east. So what's happened is Fairfield sent some volunteers out, I think, into the wilderness somewhere just to launch a bunch of orange flares at the Martians, just so everyone can get a view at night on what's going on. Whatever the cost is, apparently they all got killed by the heat ray. So that was a sacrifice, like a suicide mission. And they're using this to gain information about what the Martians are doing. So apparently all the Martians are moving together as far south as Slough, as far north as Hemel Hempstead. Big flocks of them toward Uxbridge in the east. And Fairfield goes, there's not any doubt about the target, it's London. So the flares didn't come from the aircraft then, but obviously Frank was woken by aircraft noise, so there's some aircraft up there. The sound's growing louder now. So that's the other reason they're lighting up the Martians' pits from the ground, is to guide the bombers to the Amersham pit. And Frank sees the bombers coming in now, low from the north. They think they're flown out of an airport called Northolt. Huge, heavy biplanes. These are German bombers, Gothas. So World War One bomber. A Gotha bomber is an actual World War One bomber, as far as I'm aware. They say Gothas and Giants. I'm not sure what a Giant is. Maybe that is too. Some of them have multiple engines fixed to their wings, and they're kind of large as biplanes go. And for some reason, I don't know how they're able to see this, but they could see the biplanes dropping their bombs. It's starting to happen now. There's slamming noises and detonations as the bombs hit the ground. They can hear them loud from where they are. And obviously the bombs are landing in the Martian pits. And so the Martians have seen this and they've already begun fighting back. They're using their heat rays like they did when they came out the cylinders as anti-air. And they're firing their heat rays up into the sky. Although they don't have to shoot very high up into the sky because fighting machines are quite tall. I don't know if you've noticed. So they're already kind of up there, sort of near the planes-ish. And some of the bombers, the Gotha bombers, they're exploding spectacularly in the sky from being clipped by the heat rays. And Fairfield goes, bats flying into a flamethrower, which is quite funny. And Verity goes, yet still they come, which sounds very much like a line from the musical War of the Worlds, except she continues, still the Germans come. So Fairfield is saying to Captain Jenkins, i.e. Frank, i.e. the journalist brother, to get ready because he's obviously the medical man, and they think there'll be air crews coming down and crashing, some of them still alive when they crash into the ground. And obviously some of the volunteers that shot the flares might still be alive. So his job is obviously to go out into the wilderness and give medical attention to people. We're at chapter 23, our flight from Stanmore. So Miss Elphinstone is with her sister-in-law, I think it's Alice, in Stanmore now, which I think is to the north of the Martian cordon, like on the edge where they could turn the flank. Not quite sure where Stanmore is on a map. I think maybe it's north-west-ish London. That's just a guess, though. So they're mentioning in the First War, as in the first book, the Martians began attacking London by gathering in a big crescent formation, and then obviously they fired their black smoke and let it trail off against all the artillery positions. They're saying the line the Martians are forming in this is like a bow, like, so the crescent is facing the other way and it's marching bevel first sort of thing, as a way to not have its flanks turned. I don't know if that's not really how I saw it in the first book. I saw it as the crescent just stood in that line just to throw the black smoke, essentially, and then they move normally, sort of one behind the other. Because there's that big painting of the Parson Nathaniel on the beach with his cross up, and the Martians are marching in a line. I think that's actually semi-stolen from a surrealist's artwork. I'm not sure with the guy's name, but so I kind of imagine the Martians marching in lines, kind of single file most of the time, sort of spaced out. So we're not really interested in any kind of revisionism or interpretations that revisionize the events of the first book. So we'll just say this bow thing is happening in this book. It's not happening in the last book. Because they are attempting to reach back into the past and change the meaning of what happened, or interpret and solidify what they think happened in War of the Worlds, and that's not on. So they're marching in a bow shape over the ruins of Uxbridge, with West Drayton in the south and Bushay in the north. I don't know these places. And it's not just a few machines like it was in the first book this time. It's not like 10 machines in a line. It's 50 during the course of the day, apparently. One-fifth of the entire force that has been landed in England, apparently. So they start to advance, and lots of alarms go off in London. The army run off to positions that they've prepared at this line that they've built to protect London, which is called the King's Line. And Miss Elphinstone's just, like, in a house with her sister. She's saying she couldn't see the action yet, but she could picture it. So she's not it's not very good at telling this story, because she's telling it from second-hand accounts. She's not seeing any of it. She's prepared to flee on a bicycle as fast as possible. So she's not only not seeing any of this action to report on it, but she's not seeing anything and she's ready to escape. She's saying her sister would have packed her bags full of family jewellery and photographs of George than for essentials and things. So she's trying to discipline her sister to take only stuff she needs. It's good though. It shows that she loves her husband, who's died, apparently. I think died in the previous book. Or maybe this book is saying he died in the previous book. I think it mentioned. And her sister's going, George would not want us to run like rabbits. So Miss Elphinstone's just following the news via newspapers and stuff on what's happening. She's saying the Martians' attack is fast and ruthless. On Wednesday, they wake up to the sound of church bells and sirens, police lorries with loud hailers, telling everyone to hide underground or run. Miss Elphinstone thinks maybe she's too late to escape, so she decides she should go north to try and get away from the lines, I guess, the flanks of the Martian bow. And she's thinking of getting to the Midlands to try and get trains that haven't been destroyed to the Lake District or to Scotland. Alice is arguing with her. She doesn't want to go to Scotland because she wants to preserve her home. So Alice comes up with the idea of going to France instead, because she has family connections. George had a patient she knew there in France, so she'd rather go to France than Scotland. Miss Elphinstone is adamant that the Martians aren't exactly going to spare France, because they're going worldwide this time. So Alice is adamant she wants to go to France, so Miss Elphinstone begrudgingly plans a route to try and get to the south coast. She says the sun rises on a pointlessly clear, fine spring day. The last day of March. So it's around about the same time as now in the real world. All these fucking trucks are really fucking annoying me, for fuck's sake. Their house at Stanmore's near the train station. She sees loads of big houses just shut and closed with their owners already evacuated. I think they're at the other side of the King's Line, with the King's Line facing them at this point, because she says they have to go north for a little bit anyway in order to go round the edge or flank of the King's Line so they could be allowed to pass and then go south. It'd be more like that. And she says while they're doing this, in the southwest, the Martians were approaching the King's Line. On the King's Line. So we're with Eric Eden, the military guy, one of the main characters, who I keep mistaking for Colonel Fairfield at this point. But Eric Eden's one of the more important military British guys. Eden's been restored to the rank of Major. He's outside the cordon, outside the perimeter, and he's essentially on the front line of the King's Line against the Martian attack on London. So kind of a worse place to be than in the cordon, because they'd be attacking you directly. He's at an entrenchment at a place called Western Avenue, close to the junction with Hangar Lane, north of Ealing. He's peering over the parapet of sandbags from some kind of trench, looking west, the direction from which the Martians are coming. He's wearing a gas mask, so he can't see much. For some reason, he's got a rifle in his hands with a bayonet. That's not really going to do much. There's already the roar of artillery guns opening up from behind the lines to attack the coming Martians. They say Churchill has patrolled the front lines a few days before. Unnecessary. Churchill went to these trenches and gave a speech. He's like, yeah, I'm staying in London. Break them here, men. Break through their thin crust and we'll break them everywhere, for there aren't so many of them. And if you should go down into the sleep of the just, take one with you. Hundreds of them, millions of us. We cannot help but prevail. And he's getting ass kissed as a super leader guy. Eric Eden's been told that if the Martians break through the section of line he's at, he's got a very secret weapon. Very close. So you know that that's going to come into play, obviously. The secret weapons of the Martian War is just happens to be perched somewhere behind his section of the line. So we've already had one special gun, and now there's going to be another special gun. It's early morning when the guns start firing. They have some much heavier weapons miles back, which are Navy guns, dismounted from ships and transported on railway trains. I think some of them are in the Thames as well, actually, flown on barges. And it says those are already firing and they're pounding the ground in front of the Martians. I suppose that's to make the ground just more disturbed and like, so it's harder for the Martians to stride over. But I mean, when you're that high up and striding with legs like that, you can step over anything really easily. Nothing's really an obstacle. Some of the shells are landing on abandoned properties. So they don't really care too much what they're hitting. Scraps of forests, parks are on fire. This is a creeping barrage. So if it's a creeping barrage, which is a World War II tactic in which you fire artillery into the ground and then immediately as the artillery explodes, you've got troops moving behind it. Maybe they're planning on running at the Martians here? Or does the author not know what a creeping barrage is? He's not mentioning that the troops are going to run forward straight after. They're saying the Martians are not immune to shell fire, that's well known. And they're trying to rain down like a big sheet of artillery, like sweeping the field from the King's Line out to the west, so that it hits just anything under it in a big blanket, so it's probably going to hit some Martians. But we know also that the Martians can now shoot shells and things, artillery shells out of the sky, like with anti-air heat rays. So they could probably stop some of these shells from even landing on them. Oh, no, they do know what a creeping barrage is. They say The fighting machines would supposedly be smashed and toppled, and then it would be the turn of the troops to rush ahead with automatic weapons and rifles to pick off individual Martians lying on the ground. So Eric's watching all the artillery as it does this blanket fire thing, but he can't see any Martians yet, and it's hard to see out of his gas mask. He's looking left and right at the King's line, and he sees the positions like his one, like, going off into the distance. This big human construction that's been put in place. It's built in a zigzag format, apparently, which helps if a bomb or fire goes in the trench, it doesn't spread a long distance along the trench's length. So that's interesting. And they learnt it from the Boer War. Loads of men are lined up as if in World War I, peering over the parapets of the trenches, hoping to be able to run over what I imagine to be quite a long distance of countryside if they can't even see the Martians yet, and the Martians are very tall. So they have to do a long kind of hike, I guess, with their weapons across to where the Martians supposedly would fall. So someone has spotted the Martians and they're yelling like, "There! And there! Yes, yes, I see! All along the front! Here they come!" So there are men pointing because they see the Martians. Eric finally sees them himself. They're describing the Martians in a way that doesn't go in line with the musical. They're doing it like one of the different variations of art from the book covers in the past. They're saying, "The triple narrow legs spinning and flexing, and great feet falling to the ground." So that doesn't go in line with the bowled over milking stool or the musical version. So that's trying to describe things for the fans who think of the Martians as something else, I guess. He's trying to kind of compromise between all the different art styles that have described the Martians, rather than picking one. Because, the musical, the Martians from the musical that I believe in, as the Martians, their fighting machines wouldn't be described in this way. Narrow legs spinning and flexing. Like, there's no flexing in the Jeff Wayne version of the Martians. And there's not really any spinning either, unless they're turning to face a different way. They're describing the cowl turning, the dangling metallic tentacles that hang from its undercarriage. They all come out of a big plume of smoke on the horizon towards them. So they're in like rows, like a line of Martians come out in a big row. And then behind them, there's more of them. They're like another row. So they're walking a bit like 1700s line battle kind of thing, you know, where you get the different rows of men when there are red coats and blue coats and such. All the coloured coats, like sharp, that era. I don't know how do you describe that? Early modern soldiers all moved in kind of lines. So the Martians are doing a bit of that. Like you'd see in the game Empire Total War. They're like giants coming over a bar of mist and smoke. They can't hear any sounds of the Martians yet. They can only hear the sound of their own guns firing at them. Eric Eden sees that the artillery that is heading from the Martians, he sees the heat rays are like firing beams that are exploding the shells very close to hitting the Martians. So the shells are travelling a very long way, they're almost reaching the Martians, and then they are getting anti-air exploded by the heat rays right in front of the Martians, uselessly, not even reaching their target properly. But the Martians aren't getting them all. Apparently their heat ray that shoots shells out of the air isn't perfect, whatever that technology is that they use to detect the incoming missiles. Some of them are getting hit square in the face, which is kind of funny. So some of the artillery is smashing into the fighting machines and actually killing some of them. So it is kind of like a line battle, marching on a modern army, except taller. So the soldiers in the trenches are kind of celebrating seeing some of the Martians get destroyed. And it dominoes. So this is strange. One of the Martians that gets hit, it goes, its intelligence is destroyed, and it kind of stumbles and walks around, crashes into another Martian to the right of it, who also falls over into another Martian. So they like domino three of them, but that's not what happens so much in the original War of the Worlds. The controlling intelligence, it's kind of half of the intelligence is robotic and half of it is the Martian driving the thing. So it's like if someone was to get killed or shot driving a car, the car wouldn't just stop, it'd kind of keep continuing forward. It's kind of like that. This book's saying they're kind of stopped by the artillery at the moment. Whereas in the first book, they killed the Martian while it was in the hood and the machine kept walking, and then it tripped and tumbled into the river. Saying, when the Martian hit the ground, there was a detonation as if a 50-pound shell had landed, and then there was a surge of intense heat. Apparently that one of the heat rays is somehow hitting the trench where Eric Eden is. Maybe it's fired upon, or maybe it's one of these half-destroyed Martians, not sure yet. So a lot of people in the trench have just been fired upon by the heat ray. When Eric looks up again, the Martians are helping their fallen companions who've been hit by the artillery. It seems the Martians can't help but turn and pick up their wounded fellows. So a lot of the Martians just are breaking off their attack and picking up their wounded. It could be a kind of weakness that the Martians have in a way. You know, when one goes down, they notice it and they try and pick up the broken fighting machine and take it off behind the line somewhere to repair it and save the Martian who was with them. So they're kind of compassionate to their own. It says they're making a kind of tent over the fallen ones as others continue to shoot the shells. I don't really understand that description. Are they actually making a physical tent, or are they using their bodies to form some kind of Martian shield? Some of the shrapnel's hitting the Martians' cowls and bouncing off. So the artillery stops firing now, because it can't be, because the Martians are approaching the King's Line, and the artillery can't fire anymore for risk of hitting the British and German troops in the trenches. And they're saying most of the Martians have survived this artillery attack. So the barrage has failed. They're saying the Martians are now striding over that big distance between them and the King's Line, and they're heading for the trench system. The troops are firing machine guns and sniper rifles at the Martians, but it's just kind of harmlessly pinging off the shells and the legs. And now some of the Martians have reached the trenches, and they're essentially just firing the heat ray downward at their feet. And they're calmly just kind of hosing down the trenches, the ones that have reached them. Men are catching on fire. Then there are whistles blown from the non-commissioned officers, telling everyone to fall back. And so Eric and whoever's still alive from the trenches pull out of the trenches and start running backwards to a different line, I suppose. One of the guys running with Eric says, "Next stop, Shepherd's Bush. That's where we'll stop them." So they've got more defences further back, and obviously somewhere there's that secret weapon. And wherever the army retreats from the lines, the civilians start running away with them. We have reached chapter 25, How the Retreat Began. We're back with Miss Elphinstone and Alice. They've rode on their bicycles almost to exhaustion, carrying suitcases. The roads have got too busy with evacuees, so now they have to get off their bicycles. They're making for the southeast, heading straight into central London. Edgware Road, Colindale, West Hendon, Cricklewood. They have to fight their way through the crowds. Most of the crowds are heading east, whereas they're heading south. You've got more of the stuff from the first book where people are carrying their valuables in like wheelbarrows or carts, all sorts of different kind of old wheeled contraptions full of stuff that they've taken from their houses that they want to preserve, possessions. And through the civilians are now coming some of the defeated military, ambulance and lorries. They're coming through carrying wounded from the King's Line. So some of the military is like fully evacuating away from the front line, I guess because they think they can't be of any more help up there. Some of them are unwounded and they're just cowards. They're just like running away from the battlefield. like, abandon their positions. Miss Elphinstone's aware that they're losing time getting caught up with these crowds as the Martians are approaching. They get to Paddington. They hurry through the streets south of Marylebone Road. They get to Marble Arch. There's more order at Marble Arch, less people crowding and chaotically blocking the streets here. But she sees a horde of crowds approaching from Bayswater Road into Oxford Street. There are a couple of police at Marble Arch, and in Hyde Park it's all camps set up for wounded soldiers. Alice is impressed at the order of this part of London, and she wants to stop and stay. She thinks somehow, I guess, they're going to resist the Martians by staying. She wants to get a cup of tea from the Hyde Park camps, but Miss Elphinstone hears gunfire from the west and smells smoke. She tells Alice they have to keep going. She says at that point it's good that she pushed Alice on to keep going, because the Martians are at a place called Wormwood Scrubs. Not sure where that is. I actually think that's a name of a prison. That rings a bell as being a name of a prison somewhere. I guess it's a part of London where the Martians have got into. And that's today's five chapters.